Hi, today I'm going to teach you how to make print and play cards. And we'll start off with one way which is really easy and more or less anyone can do it, minimum of tools, but it produces cards that maybe aren't the best to play with. They're perfectly usable but not so great. We'll have another way which is fairly easy still but produces much nicer and more handleable cards. Not quite as good as the creme de la creme of print and play cards, a good feel, fronts and backs, and almost indistinguishable from commercial cards. For our first method, this is something more or less anyone can do, and you just need to print off the cards, and this is the format that most print and play cards come in. You've got all of the cards are laid out, no gaps between them, and often in a 3x3 grid of cards. And you really just need a pair of scissors, some sleeves, and these are really cheap penny sleeves, and some regular playing cards. And you could also use magic cards or whatever to bang these, just any other playing cards which are the same size as the sleeves. It helps if you have a ruler and a pencil as well, because sometimes you'll need to draw lines between the crop marks because the designer of the cards hasn't laid out lines between all of the cards, but they're not always essential and you can often get by with just the scissors. Okay, the first task is to find these crop marks, which are there for cutting the page up with a knife or a rotary cutter. And because we're just going to use a pair of scissors for this, we need to join those crop marks up with a pencil. So you need to line the ruler very carefully up with the marks, and then keeping the ruler in place, draw a line right the way down the page. And we need to repeat this between every pair of crop marks until we've divided the page up into 9 separate cards. Now, some of the cards on this page are half the size, and we need to deal with those separately a little bit later. And just to get at this last bit, I'm folding the paper up like this, not actually creasing it, but just lifting it up so that it doesn't hit me in the chest, as I bring it close enough to see over the ruler to draw these lines right at the end. Now we've got the piece of paper divided clearly, all of the lines we need to cut down very clearly marked out with a pencil, we can carefully take our scissors and start cutting out the cards. And it's really just a case of cutting along all of the lines you just drew in pencil. It doesn't really matter if you're not especially accurate at this stage, because these are just going to be put in sleeves in a minute anyway, and the sleeve will make sure that when you're playing the game all of the cards seem the same size anyway, because the sleeve itself will be the same size. Now, the simplest option, if you've got normal sized cards, these are poker size, is to simply get some card sleeves. Here I'm using black backed Ultra Pro, because if you use a coloured back, then you don't have to worry about the backs on the card, so it's quicker. Obviously, you can also use cheap penny sleeves, like these ones, which are flimsier and have no coloured back, but they're much cheaper. And then you simply use regular playing cards. So for each sleeve, we open it up, slide in a playing card, and then take one of our cut up bits of paper and slide that thing in front of the card. And because these are basically the same size as the card, they're going to be a little bit tricky to get in sometimes, because they're quite a tight fit. And then you've got a perfectly good, solid, finished card, essentially. And if we can just do these for the other two. There you have, ready to play. The good thing about these is that they are shuffleable, very easy. They are riffle shuffleable if you want to flick through your cards. And you can merge them together very easily. If you've got a whole stack of these, you can just push them together and they're very easy to use. The downside is they slide around all over the place. So the problem with these miniature sized cards is that they are a little bit big for a standard card sleeve. So luckily, somebody does make miniature sized sleeves, which these do fit into. I'm using Fantasy Flight's mini European board game size, which are 44 by 68 millimeter card size. The other problem, of course, is that we don't have any blank playing cards to go in here. You can find them, but they're not very common, and realistically, I wouldn't want to rely on having them when I want to make a print and play game. So we're going to have to come up with something else. Rather than cut down regular playing cards into half sizes, which is an option, I'm going to take a bit of cardstock, mark out rectangles of the correct size, 44 by 68 millimeters, and cut them to fit in the sleeves. So I will start out by marking ticks every 68 millimeters along the top of the paper, and then also along the bottom. And hopefully you can see these are now the correct width to fit in our cards. And if I now mark 44 millimeters ticks in the other direction, I should only need four rows of these, since that's how many rows of cards there were in the original sheet. These are now the right width, so each of these rectangles should neatly fit inside the card sleeve. Now, you can cut these out with the scissors in the same way that we did for the card faces, but just to save time, I'm going to use a rotary cutter, a paper trimmer. Now, obviously you could use the paper trimmer for cutting out the faces as well, if you so wished, but not everyone has one, and scissors are perfectly good. So that's what we used. Generally speaking, you don't have to do this at all, because most print and play games only use standard poker-sized cards anyway. And there we have some card snifters, each of which is exactly the right size to slide into one of our miniature sleeves. Now we just have to fill out each of our sleeves with the paper face in front of the freshly cut card stiffener. And it's worth bearing in mind, if you do care about whether you can see the difference between one card and the next, there will potentially be some pencil marks on some of these, so make sure they're all facing the same way. Here are the pencil marks on the front. This will be the back, which is completely clean, and we can put our printed face in front of the pencil. And there you have all of your miniature cards sleeved, shuffleable, and playable. If you want your print and play games to have card backs, and you're using sleeves, then obviously the answer is very simple. You print out all of the backs, you cut them up in exactly the same manner, and then you slide the bits of paper for the back into the back of the sleeve. Now, I'll use the paper trimmer again for the backs, and the advantage of that is that we only have to draw the lines in one direction, because we're going to cut the others using the crop marks. You will often find with these sleeved cards that the lengths of paper that need to fit into the sleeve all at the same time make them bow a bit. So to avoid that, you can trim just a little bit extra off the bottom of each of these, just a little sliver. Now we can separate out the backs. And now we have a number of cards with fronts and backs, neatly kept in sleeves, and our game is pretty much ready to play. For this next method, we're going to produce slightly more handleable cards, but this comes at a bit of a cost. So first of all, we're going to be using label paper, which is a full sheet label, sticky on the back, and we'll also be using proper playing cards, but this time we'll actually be using up one playing card permanently. With sleeves, you can always take the cards out again and reuse them for another game. With this option, we're going to be labeling the cards directly. So when you print out your label, there's two things to be very careful of. The first one is select the label paper type on your printer dialog. If you can set it on the printer directly, that's even safer because that's guaranteed to stick. Otherwise, in the driver, make sure you select label paper type, because your printer will, in the case of a laser printer, it will fuse at a higher temperature and make sure that the toner is stuck to the label properly. In the case of an inkjet, it might put a little bit more ink on in the case of a label print, because you don't want this to be rubbing off or becoming a little bit patchy. The second thing to be careful of is to print at 90% scale. And the reason for this is, if you don't, then the label will reach right the way to the outside edges of the playing card. And that means that you'll have to be very, very careful lining it up. If you print at 90%, then you've got plenty of margin all the way around. You've got 3 to 5 millimeters on each side of the card to make sure that you don't have to be especially careful about the alignment. We're only going to be sticking on the label on one side, so you don't have to worry about the backs. There'll be the standard backs of the playing cards, and they'll all look identical anyway. Now, again, you can cut these out with the scissors, and you can use the same method with the ruler and drawing a pencil line across if you want to. In this case, I'm going to use a knife, because generally speaking, you'll get a better cut with a knife. It'll be easier to make nice, long, straight cuts, so the edges of the label will be cleaner, and that will mean that they're less susceptible to damage later on. So what we're going to do is we're going to cut this into 9 separate little labels, and we're going to label up the fronts of our cards. So I buy pretty cheap playing cards. This one cost me, I believe, £1.70, which is a little bit over $2 US. And I have many of these decks of cards, which I use entirely for prototyping, print and play, and so on. So for this, we will be using a ruler and a knife for the cuts. You could use scissors, you could pencil out the lines the same way we did in the sleeved version, but this is a little bit quicker if you're used to it. Obviously, it's very important to use a sharp knife. I've put a new blade in this just for this purpose. And the easiest way to do this is to make the cuts from one crop mark to the next, but not to go past the edges of the paper, because then each strip of cards will remain attached to the sheet, and you can just cut in both directions and use the crop marks in both cases. I've made all the horizontal cuts, and you can see all the cards are still attached to the sheet, so we can still use these crop marks to make the vertical cuts. Now, when you do this, it's best to start in the middle of the paper, because then you have the shortest bit of paper left attached. If we cut here first, then we'll have this whole flap flopping around, and it will be harder to line up this cut and this cut. So we'll start as close to the middle as we can. So we've now released these middle ones, and we can go up to the edges and cut the last two cuts to release the last 6 cards. Again, when you are making a cut, if you possibly can, if one side is waste and one side is to be kept, keep the keep side underneath your ruler and have the waste side over here, because like that, if you do mess up your cut and your knife goes off like that, then you haven't messed up a card, you've just messed up the waste bit down the side. Obviously, sometimes it's not possible, sometimes you'll have a card on either side of your cut and you just have to be careful. But wherever you can, keep the waste side out from your ruler and the thing you want to keep underneath your ruler. On this last cut in particular, it's important to make sure that the paper is as flat as possible, because if it isn't, this might be tucked like that underneath your ruler and you won't make a straight cut. Make sure it's flat before you make the cut, and you can be sure that your cut will be straight and cut directly down the side of all 3 of these cards. Now, we have 9 playing cards, 9 card size labels. Because we printed the labels smaller than they needed to be, smaller than the actual card size, we've got a border all the way around, so we've got plenty of space to align this without getting really picky about getting it exactly precise, because that's never going to happen. And we now need to pick up the edge of the label paper and paste it down onto the card. Now, when you are picking up the edge, if you've got fingernails, then you might well be able to pick the edge of the label down. And I don't trim mine all the way back, almost precisely for this reason. If you don't, then you can take the point of a knife and just sort of stab it a little bit into the paper there, just enough to get a grip on it, because as you pull it back, you see that? It will pull the backing away from the label itself. And that hasn't gone all the way through. You don't want to go all the way through. You're not trying to push it in through the paper, you're just trying to stab it in enough that it gets a bit of a grip on the paper, and it'll pull the label back. Once you've got a corner up, we'll use this one I got with the knife a second ago, you want to pull it away just 5 to 10 millimeters from the end, so about a quarter to a third of an inch. Like this, the majority of the label isn't sticky, and we can move it around easily. So we place it down on a flat surface. We can align the label easily, and for example, if we move it too far over there, you can start to see the card index. So we want to try and avoid that. We'll align it carefully, just so it's as evenly across the card as possible, and then we can stick down this exposed edge. We flip it up, pull the backing out from underneath it, and smooth it down. If you've got particularly greasy hands, you can use the back of your cork-backed ruler, which is really quite nice and soft, to smooth the label down so you don't have to worry about messing up the card face. And there you have one finished, labeled-up card. And it still has the nice, smooth texture of the playing card, but it now has your custom face. And we just have to do that 8 more times. Now, I've been just whipping the backing out here and smoothing it down in one go, but that's because I've had a lot of practice. If you're not that certain about it, then just pull the backing back just a little bit, smooth the label down a bit, pull the backing down a bit more, smooth the label down a bit more, because the last thing you want is for this to get creased on the surface of the card and not lay flat. It's really important with this method that your cards labels lay completely flat. Once you've done this, you can more or less shuffle these like normal cards. They will riffle shuffle, because normal cards do. They handle pretty much like normal cards, because you still have this one regular playing card surface. You've got that nice linen finish with the nice coating on it, and that will slide more or less as well as a regular set of playing cards, with the difference that you have your PMP game on the inside. And these are not indestructible, of course. If you play a lot with a deck of cards like this, then the label will eventually start to peel up. And especially if you do a lot of merging your cards from the side, because obviously as one card hits another, it can potentially catch on that label like that, and that will cause it to start peeling up at the edge. So, while these handle a lot better than sleeves do, they're a lot easier to play with, definitely a lot easier to deal out, and a lot easier to stack than sleeves. You do have to be careful still not to mistreat them in the same way that you can mistreat playing cards on their own. Okay, this third method is the nicest in that it produces the nicest cards, but it's also the most effort. And the first thing you need to do is make sure the cards are laid out in a particular manner. This is the template, which you can use on your computer to lay out the cards to make sure that you have the fronts and the backs laid out on opposite sides of the paper. You do four cards per sheet with this, and you have all of the fronts on one side of the sheet and all of the backs on the other side of the sheet. Now, the most important thing, which is clear on this template, is that there's a common fold line down the centre of the sheet. And this fold line, the centre of these three lines here, is equally distant from the bottoms of these cards and the tops of these cards. So that when you fold the sheet along this line, the fronts and the backs line up perfectly. And that's the secret of this method, really. It ensures that you have the fronts and the backs of your cards are lined up very easily. You don't have to worry about holding them up to the light and aligning them carefully and putting them together with tape. It's very easy. For this method, I'm going to cut with a rotary cutter and a steel ruler. You could equally do it with a knife, as long as your knife is very sharp. You could, of course, do this with a pair of scissors. You could lay the ruler along and draw your pencil lines as before, but the closer you get to really nice cards, the more worthwhile it is putting the extra effort in to use a more precise tool. The first step with this method, once you've printed all of your sheets off, and I'm using a nice linen paper here because it gives a very good finish, there's a nice texture on it, is to spray them. You'll spray them with a clear lacquer. I'm using a UK Auto Shop brand, but anything which is a clear and acrylic lacquer, gloss is best, will do decently. And the reason you need to do this is twofold. Firstly, having a gloss finish on the cards will help with the slide. It will make sure they have that good playing card level of friction. And the linen paper helps with that as well. So ideally you will use linen paper for this, but you can get away with regular paper if you don't have any. The second reason for the gloss is that it protects the printing. Especially with laser printing, if you cut along the edge, you'll find that the toner starts to chip. And especially with inkjet printing, you'll find as you handle the cards, then grease from your finger, moisture from the air and so on will start to damage the printing, and you might find it smudges under your fingers and thumbs. Lacquer it, and you don't have to worry about any of that. It will stay pristine for a much longer time. Now, the most important thing when you're spraying is to shake the can thoroughly before you start, and it's tedious and it makes your arm ache, but you really do need to shake it for at least a minute. The second thing to remember when you're spraying is to spray from a distance of about 20 centimeters, which is around 8 inches, and keep the can moving. Don't ever concentrate in one spot because it will cause the lacquer to pool in that area and then you'll just get it running and it will ruin the finish. And begin your spray and end your spray off of the thing you're spraying. So start here, spray across there, let go. Obviously you can spray and go back and forth and back and forth. Try not to turn the can over your thing either, because again, it will cause a buildup of the lacquer in that particular area and you'll get a bad finish. The other really important thing to do when spraying is to do it somewhere else. Don't do it inside, the fumes will build up and they're bad for you. I'm going to do it in the garage and I'm going to wear a respirator. You can also do it outside if it's not windy and not too humid. So the first thing we need to do is fold this so that the fronts and the backs of each card line up properly. The template here has the marks down the center, which will show you where your line should be, your fold should be. And I actually prefer to join these up with a pencil, or just to arrange the cards in a template that has this line marked all the way down the page. Because like that, I can be sure while I'm folding it that I'm on the fold all the way down the page, because it's pretty important with this that the fold is completely straight, which is, it turns out, not that easy to do by hand. So the first thing to do is at each corner where you actually have the printed on crop mark or fold mark, just pinch the paper together, and you might find it necessary to roll the paper with your thumb and forefinger here to make sure you find exactly where to fold it. and just pinch that together into a crease right at that point. Now, what we're looking to do here, obviously, is to line this crease up all the way down the page. So again, at each point, we want to slowly bring the paper to a crease and roll it back and forth until that printed mark is right on where the crease is going to be, and then pinch it firmly into a proper crease. And now we need to lay it flat and fold each of these pairs of cards right down the center line. And this is why it helps to have that line drawn on there, because you can then see exactly where your fold is going to be and make sure that your drawn line is right on the crease when you press it down firmly. The next step is to spray glue the inside of our folded sheets. And once we've done that, we're going to wrap them around some cardstock. So it's worth getting the cardstock out in advance so we know that we're not going to be fussing around with it once we get back from spraying. And the idea is we wrap the printed and glued linen paper around the outside of the cardstock. The fronts and the backs will line up perfectly because we made that careful fold. And like this, we can glue them in place. One load of spray glue will do both the fronts and the backs at the same time, and we can then simply cut them out and we'll have perfect cards. So I generally find I can do about three of these at once. So I'll lay them out open, and you can, if you need extra help getting them to lay flat because you've folded them, you can just sort of fold the corners out a little bit like that, and then they'll lay flat enough to be sprayed. They don't need to be perfect. Three is about the number you can manage at once. After that, obviously, it's harder to carry them, and the glue will start to dry before you can use it properly. For this, I'm using a 3M photo mount, which is pretty readily available, fairly affordable, and perfectly good for print and play cards. The important thing to bear in mind, any spray glue can be used. You want to try and avoid rubber cement based spray glues, because some will spit out a load of messy rubber, and they're fine if you're laminating a Formica kitchen top or something, but they're no good for print and play because you'll feel all the lumps underneath the card. And other types you want to avoid are repositionable, because that really just means that the glue will never completely dry and you can always lift them up, and that's obviously no good for cards. This photo mount I find very good. There's another one 3M do called Craft Mount, which is also perfectly good. And there are obviously various other brands which are equally good, but I've just not tried them, so I can't tell you. So, once we've got this spray glued, you can see it's quite tacky, we want to make sure that the backs of the cards are facing towards us and as flat on the surface as we can. It doesn't matter if it's perfect. What we need to do is line this bit of cardstock, which is going to be the core of our card, up with the fold. However, we don't want to actually push it right the way into the fold. We want it to be laid about 2 or 3 millimeters back from the fold. Remember that the card's printing goes about 5 millimeters away from the fold, so that's the maximum distance for our cardstock. And it helps if you sort of peer over the top of it, hold it taut but not super tight, and then just lower it slowly into place until it contacts the linen sheet. And then you can smooth it down. And you see, nowhere down there do we have more than 5 millimeters between the card and the fold, so this is a good one. It's going to be easily far enough this way to be past the edge of the printing on the backs. Then we simply fold this over, and this is the part where we need the fold to be as precise as possible. So start in the middle, just touch it down so it holds in place, and then run your fingers along the fold like that so that it lays down flat. Again, starting in the middle, smooth it outwards and away from the fold, like so. And one of the reasons that you have the backs down when you start is that so that, like this, all the times that you're applying pressure, you're rubbing along the fronts of the cards. These are the bits that it doesn't really matter if you damage them at all. Obviously, you try and not to if you can, But because you smooth down the card onto the backs and you smooth down the fronts onto the card, you should find that the backs are also perfectly smoothed down. Double check, give it a quick wipe if you want to, but you want to try and avoid doing any rubbing motion on the back as much as you can, because this is the part where you really don't want to rub the ink off or smudge it or whatever. Okay, and then we have one perfectly glued down, perfectly aligned pair of cards. If you want to double check the alignment, you don't need to, it's a bit too late by now, but you can take a sharp knife with a point on it. I'm not going to stab my finger to demonstrate the point. And just line it up with one of those crop marks and stab it right the way down through the page like that. More or less directly on the crop mark on that side. So that is a perfectly aligned back to face. If this happens, fold over from the good part where there's a distance away, because that's going to be the correctly aligned fold. And just smooth it down, take a knife, and just reach in and cut underneath the paper into the fold like that. So you're putting the knife right up into the corner of the fold, because again, that bit of the paper doesn't matter. What we need is for this part to be aligned with the other parts. When we are cutting our cards out, the first thing we want to bear in mind is to make all of our cuts from the back of the card. And like this, we can ensure that we line our ruler up with the crop marks on this side, and all of the backs will be identical. If the other side isn't perfectly aligned, which sometimes it won't be, then it doesn't matter so much. If you're looking at your hand of cards and some of the faces are slightly crooked, that's fine. But if you're looking at the backs of someone else's hands of cards and you can say, ah, I know what that card is because that's the one which is slightly to the side, that's bad. You make all of your cuts from the back, and you can make sure that all of your backs are identical. It's very tempting to just run the first cut along between these two crop marks, because it's a nice, long, easy cut. However, if we do that, we'll lose all of these crop marks all the way along this edge, and that means it will find it harder to cut the long sides of the card. So it's actually better if we do those ones first. And again, whenever you are using a ruler, whether it's with a rotary cutter or a knife, it's best to align your cut so that the thing you want to keep is underneath the ruler. So in this case, the card is underneath the ruler and the waist is exposed to the side. So we make our cut, and if we do wander a bit, if we do push here and it goes off, then we're going into the waist. And in between each card, you've got a good 8 millimeters or so of waist. So even if you wander a little bit, it's fine. You can just remake the cut, get it nice and straight and clean, and it doesn't matter that you've messed up the waist a bit. When you make these cuts, if you can, we want to start just this side of this crop mark and finish just that side of that crop mark. If you don't feel confident doing that, then it's fine to just start at this end and go all the way up. But we want to keep as much of the frame attached as possible, because that's what gives us our crop marks for the next cut. And if we, again, similarly to this long cut, if we slice all the way off there, we would lose these two marks and we wouldn't be able to align those two cuts perfectly. So we'll line our cut up, and we want to be cutting from about there to about there. And again, take a few passes without too much pressure, and that's safer and easier than trying to push all the way through in one cut. Again, we'll skip this line, the bottom side of this card, because the card's the wrong way around. So we'll just do the tops of all of these cards, and then we'll turn the paper around and do all of the bottoms. Okay, now we've cut all of one side, we can flip it around and start making the cuts on the other side of each of the cards. And again, we're keeping the bit we want underneath the ruler and cutting with the waist exposed. Here, obviously, we need to start off the cut this side of the crop mark and run our blade all the way down to the outside and take a few lighter passes rather than one heavy one, because it's always the heavy cuts where you're putting a lot of pressure. Those are the ones you're most likely to slip. Now we've done all of the long sides of the cards, now we can come back and take off the ends here, because now we don't need these crop marks anymore. We've made all those cuts. So we can just slice all the way along the end there and take all of those ends off at the same time. It's important to put enough pressure up here as you go past, because that is the most likely point for the ruler to pivot away from you and get a badly aligned cut. And finally, we can spin our paper around so that we keep the bit we want under the ruler and the waste exposed. And we can make this final cut to separate all of our cards from the waste. And again, make sure you're putting enough pressure up here. Don't push really hard with the rotary cutter to avoid it pivoting at the end there and messing up that last card. And there we have it. That's separated. Each of our cards is now a separate piece. And if we turn them over, we'll find that the faces are perfectly aligned. An even border on each one. As with everything else, there are many options when it comes to corner rounding, and three of the most popular are a simple sort of metal bypass cutter. This has got a spring at the back and a metal plate here with your corner radius, and the sprung part at the back here has another metal blade essentially on it there, and as you close it, one bit of metal passes by the other and cuts a corner off of the edge of your card. So if we take a bit of our scrap here as an example, you tuck it up, line it up against these two fences, and then clip off the corner. And the problem with these is they're not very good, basically. So with thick bits of card, you have to chomp it quite hard, and sometimes it just will never go through. So these are generally quite good for rounding bits of paper and thinner bits of card. But as soon as you've built up a thicker lamination of papers and cards, especially if they're a little bit flexible, unfortunately, you'll find that it's quite hard to actually get all the way through with this cutter, and you often get this messy, tatty edge. The next option is the crocodile. And I've put a bit of label paper in there so it's easier for me to see exactly where the corner is. It works on a very similar principle. This top plate is a flat surface. These are your fences, which you line up against. And at the back there, you've got a blade, which as you work the handles, passes down past the flat plate and cuts a corner off of whatever's in there. These are capable of working with much thicker stock. They generally easily deal with our homemade cards and cut a nice corner off where the previous cutter couldn't. And they come in a variety of radii. This one is either 1/8 an inch or 3/8 of an inch. And 1/8 of an inch is approximately a 3 millimeter radius. However, my absolute favorite is this thing. This is a very heavy duty cutter. You can see by the size of the metal plates at the front here. It's only a single radius and it will take more or less anything. I have used this to round off the corners on 2 millimeter grey board, which is monster stuff, and this goes through it without a problem. It's got a very, very good mechanical advantage on the handle there. And the blade is not going to wear out anytime soon. So I really prefer this for my cards. And it is, again, a simple case of line the card right up into the corner, chop down, and it makes a very nice rounded corner on the edge there. I would recommend this for everyone. If you can't afford one of these is definitely doable. It will cut the corner here very nicely. I wouldn't recommend this at all for homemade cards. It's okay if you're printing on cardstock and then you are cutting the corners on that cardstock and using the cardstock as it is. As soon as you start laminating stuff together, it starts to fall over, unfortunately. But for my projects, I always use this for my cards because it's so reliable and nice. always cut your corners from the same side of the card, and generally I would recommend the back, because again, you want to do all of your cutting from the back to make sure that your backs are indistinguishable from each other. And you will get perfectly rounded corners and these will be very difficult to tell the difference between these and professionally made cards. While the glue, the spray glue, is still a little bit damp, I guess, not cured properly, these are not amazingly stiff and you'll find that they don't riffle as well as regular playing cards do. However, once they dry, once the glue cures, they become a lot stiffer. Because of the combination of the linen paper and the coating we gave it with the spray lacquer, they slide around just like regular playing cards do. You can do the same. Drop them in a stack, they stay in place. Drop them sideways and they slide. The most important test for a deck of cards is how will they shuffle? And these slide very nicely. You can flip them back and forth, but most importantly, you can absolutely riffle shuffle them. If you're not rubbish at riffle shuffling. And there you have it. My favourite print and play cards. My next favourite print and play cards. And the easiest and cheapest print and play cards to make.